Let's take a quick look at the setup and use of the DNS beacon. So I'm going to start a Cobalt Strike client, and I'm going to connect it to malwarec2.losenolove.com. And here we are. I also have a terminal open to where I am running the malwarec2.losenolove.com team server from. Let's go ahead and create a DNS beacon listener. Go to Cobalt Strike listeners, press add, and choose beacon DNS as the payload. We're going to call this EC2 DNS. Now for the DNS host, we need to put in one or more domains that our Cobalt Strike team server is the authoritative name server for. And again, that means we've created an NS record that delegates this domain or subdomain to our Cobalt Strike team server. So let's go ahead and put in freepicks.losenolove.com. And I'm comfortable with that. Press save. And there we go. We now have a DNS beacon listener running on this Cobalt Strike team server. And if we come over here to the terminal, you can see that yes, indeed, the DNS server has started, or DNS listener has started. Let's test it out a little bit. The thing I like to do is to issue a message like test.freepicks.losenolove.com. And if everything works, we should get back the DNS idle response for the team server. By default, this is 0000. Let's try something that, let's make a typo here. If we type something that doesn't exist, of course, we don't get back an answer. So I just want you to see that difference. If you do a test lookup and you don't get back that idle response, something is wrong and you'll want to troubleshoot what's happening. Another thing you can do that's kind of cool, just to see what I showed you in the DNS beacon that could slide, is you can do a trace of an iterative query. So if we do dig plus trace test.freepicks.losenolove.com, you can see the path made to actually resolve this domain to something. And dig starts out by reaching out to the root servers for the internet, and it keeps getting referred down until we get to, let's see here, the root server for the internet, the root servers for .com. Then we get the authoritative name server for losenolove.com. And finally, we end up at the authoritative name server for freepicks.losenolove.com, malwarec2. And we get a response to our query from malwarec2.losenolove.com. So that's a way of seeing what I showed you a little bit earlier. But I think we're good to go. This DNS infrastructure seems to be working. And again, most of the time when I'm testing, I just do an NS lookup, but on the correct domain. And that's how I make sure everything is sane and working. All right, let's go ahead and create a PowerShell one-liner to run our DNS beacon. So we're gonna go to attacks, web drive-by, scripted web delivery. Press dot, dot, dot. Choose our EC2 DNS beacon. We'll do a 64-bit payload and press launch. And there we go. Here's our one-liner that we can use to run the DNS beacon on a target. Here we are on a Windows 10 target system. And again, we're just gonna paste in that one-liner, press OK, and jump back to our Kali Linux box. And here we are back in Kali Linux. And you can see we have what some people like to call a ghost beacon. Really, it's not a ghost. It's just a beacon that we don't have any metadata for yet. By the way, anything that makes a lookup on our team server that matches a pattern that looks like a DNS beaconing message is going to create a ghost beacon. So be aware of that. But to get the beacon to send metadata to us, what we need to do is right click, interact, and give it something to do, some reason to talk to us. So I'm just going to use the sleep command and tell beacon to check in every 5 seconds instead of the default 1 minute, which is in the default profile. And when the 1 minute time rolls around, you will see we now have metadata for this particular beacon. We can see it's PowerShell XE in PID 7780. It's a 64-bit beacon, and now it's checking in every 5 seconds. So that's the DNS beacon. And the DNS text record channel is pretty performant. You can do a lot of things with it. For example, if we take a screenshot, the DNS beacon is going to download the screenshot tool over the course of multiple TXT record requests by default. And once it gets the tool and runs it, it will send a screenshot back to us via several long host names. And I'm showing you this because this is a very normal routine thing you might do with a beacon. But I want you to be aware that DNS is a constrained channel. It takes a lot of requests to download a capability and to get output back, especially when it's something as big as a screenshot. But if you're patient, the capability does work. It's pretty robust, and we will actually get the result we expect back. And I do want to point out that as I'm doing this demo, everything is over the internet, so this is a realistic demonstration, realistic latency. And there we are. We now have our screenshot and go to view, screenshots. And we can see that this is the screenshot of our Windows 10 target where we ran the DNS beacon. So that's the TXT record channel. And the TXT record channel is the best you're going to get with DNS. There's another channel, DNS6, where Cobalt Strike will use, again, Quad A records to download taskings and shorter host names to send data back. You could probably take a screenshot over a Quad A channel. It's just going to take a lot longer to download the capability and to get the data back. And if you're using the A record channel, for low bandwidth things, it's just fine to control the beacon. But if you try to take a screenshot or do something that is very large, when you chunk it up into four byte chunks, just be aware it's going to take a really, really, really long time. I have actually escalated privileges and controlled a namepipe beacon over an A record channel before. I think in that one network, it took a couple hours to actually stage everything, but it can be done. But just be aware that if you try to do something really big, like run Mimikatz over an A record DNS channel, it is going to take a very, very long time for your beacon to actually download to download that capability and run it. And also be aware that if you use something like the A record channel, that you are going to be spamming the wire with a lot of DNS requests when you try to do something. The benefit of the A record channel is that if you can beacon, meaning you can actually see the agent checking in over DNS, the A record channel is going to likely be able to actually communicate with you. And I very much see this channel as a way to recover the agent when using DNS text records as a channel isn't working for you. So that's a little bit on the DNS beacon.